Welcome to Ace Review TV, live broadcasted from Studio De Blok. In the next hour, we explain all about the project Ace Review with our team members Laura and Sophie. We will have a nice discussion about how AI can be used in the process of systematic reviewing with Jan and Felix. We will explain everything about active learning for screening prioritization with NLP experts Ayoub and Daniel. And we have the opportunity to ask everything about Jonathan, our lead engineer. But first, I would like you to introduce you to my co-host, Lars Tummers, professor at the School of Governance at Utrecht University. Lars, I've heard you're actually called Lars Systematic Review Tummers. Why is that?
Yeah, it's always funny to have nicknames. And it first started when I was working at University of California, Berkeley, and I wanted to do a literature review. So I walked into the professor I was working with at Berkeley, and I was a very ambitious person at that point in my life. And I said, I want to write 6 papers together with you. He said, we're not going to do that, Lars. We're going to do 1 paper, but 1 good paper. I said, okay. We want to do a systematic literature review on a particular topic, and it was about stress of civil servants versus police officers, nurses, all those kind of people. And I was looking like, okay, how can you do a systematic literature review? And I found insights in the medical sciences. So I started reading those kinds of documents and applied them to my own field, public administration, organizational science. And I also infected a lot of the PhD students I was working with. And in the end, I published a lot of systematic reviews. And that's why I got that nickname. So it's a funny, but it's a good nickname to have, I think.
Yeah, but Lars, what is actually the problem with systematic reviewing?
I think the main problem is that it takes a huge amount of time. Mm. So people come into my office and ask, oh, Lars, I know that you're doing systematic literature reviews. Can you help me? I say, yeah, do you have like 1.5 years? I say, what are you talking about? Say, yeah, do you want to do it systematically, transparently, using the guidelines? Yeah, probably, yeah. But yeah, okay, it's like, you have a lot of papers, think like 10,000 papers, like a big pile of papers, but only 50 are relevant. But each time you have to go there, you have to pick a paper, you have to look at it, and then say, irrelevant. You toss it away, and then irrelevant. You have to do all 10,000, and literally 10,000. So one of my colleagues, a PhD student, she literally reviewed 10,000 papers, and in the end, I think 100 or something were relevant.
But why do you then even start such a project? Why?
I think normally what we did before in our field was just what they call like, they call it literature review, but mostly it's like, okay, I know some books, you know some books and some articles, let's just write a review about that. But that's very unsystematic, it's very biased by your own experience. And if you want to do it systematically, you have to really take like a broader look, like take a panorama picture, and then gather all these insights. So you do it to understand the literature.
But why is that in your field so important to understand all the literature? Why not just citing some of your colleagues, your friends? So the difference between a review and a systematic review, why is it important to have it in a systematic way?
It's like what some people said, science is also standing upon the shoulders of giants. So you don't start from scratch. You don't start from only what your professor knows, or what a colleague knows. You want to know the most important points about a topic and then build on it. And in order to do that, it's like building a house. If your house is built like with rotten wood or something, it just falls apart very quickly. With a systematic literature, although it takes a lot of time, like building a house takes a lot of time, but you have to do it if you want to really progress science. And there are, of course, many faults also in the literature, but you have to know them. So that's why often when I start also supervising PhD students, not all the time, but most of the time, we start with such a review or a meta-analysis.
So many of the PhD students perform a systematic review in your field?
Yes, some I supervise, so they may sometimes they don't have a choice or something to do that. Many do that. Yes, not always systematic, but many start with a literature review.
Okay, yeah. Cool. So Lars, thank you so much for accepting the invitation to become a co-host in this broadcast. What we're going to do in the next hour, we're going to explain everything about the software. We have some nice discussions, but I first want to briefly explain the project, because it's a research project, a multidisciplinary project conducted at Utrecht University. So there are a lot of people involved, statisticians from the Department of Methods and Statistics. We have data scientists from the focus area Applied Data Science, information specialists from our university library, research software engineers from the IT department, experts from the Open Data Program. We have a lot of students writing their thesis topic with us or doing their trainees with us. And we have many substantive researchers involved in our project. So this makes it a huge project, and we are trying to share our enthusiasm today. So let's first listen to Laura Hofstee for an introduction to the general idea of using ASReview for systematic reviews. Laura, the floor is yours.
So now I'm going to tell you about ASReview in a nutshell. And what I love about this program, that you, the user, are in control. It's not the machine making decisions, you are. But before I tell you more about ASReview, I want to talk to you about the traditional way of screening. So traditionally, you start with a search. And the search, out of the search come maybe thousands of papers. And you have to screen the whole data set, so all these thousands of papers. And after that long and exhausting process, you end up with this little stack of papers, which is actually relevant for your study. And then you write your awesome publication. With ASReview, it works a bit differently, but the start is the same. So you again start with your search and the thousands of papers, but then you get a little help of our friend called ALAS, our Electronic Learning Assistant. ALAS helps you by reordering the papers such that the relevant papers are pushed to the front. And you don't have to screen the whole data set, you can just screen part of the data set. After this, you again end up with this little stack of papers which are relevant for your study, and you can write your awesome publication. So let's go into more depth about the screening process. In the traditional way, you grab a random record from the stack, you screen it and decide whether it's relevant or not. Then again, you grab a record, screen it, decide whether it's relevant or not. And again, until you've seen the whole data set. And remember, this might be thousands of papers you have to screen, so this is a very long process. And after you screened it all, you can stop with the screening process and export your records and start on to the full text screening. With ASReview, the beginning is a bit different, but this makes that eventually you save a lot of time. So you start with importing the records, so the data set in ASReview. And then you have to give ALAS a little bit of information about what you are looking for in a record and what you're not looking for. So you have to give ALAS at least one relevant and one irrelevant paper. Then you have to decide on the settings, but we have defaults for this. And Sophie will show you more about the priors and the settings in her demonstration. So now ALAS is going to work for you. ALAS is calculating probability scores for all the data that you haven't seen yet, which are all the papers except for the priors you gave to ALAS. This is the information that ALAS uses to calculate these scores. So ALAS gives you the paper of which ALAS thinks it has the highest probability to be relevant. And then you, the user, screen this paper and decide whether it's actually relevant or not. So you see, you are in control. It's not ALAS making the decisions. ALAS just gives you the paper and you decide whether it's relevant or not. Then ALAS goes to work again. Now based on the prior information and the decision you just made, ALAS recalculates all the scores. So you made ALAS a bit smarter. And ALAS again gives you the paper of which ALAS thinks it has the highest probability to be relevant. And you screen it and decide whether it's relevant or not. And this process goes on and on until you decide to stop. But remember, you don't have to screen the whole data set, you can just screen part of it. So after you decide to stop, you can export your records and start to the full text screening. So you see that the ASReview way is way faster than the traditional way of screening. And not only that, it's also very easy to use and you, the user, stay in control.
It all started 3 years ago. I was working on a systematic review myself about trajectories of post-traumatic stress development. We had to screen 6,185 abstracts to include only 34 in the final paper. I think you can imagine how I felt during screening so many papers. And this is why we started the AS Review project. With great help from some experts from the university library, among others Jan de Boer and Felix Weidema. Felix, you support many researchers in systematic reviewing using what's called the Prisma checklist. Can you explain a bit more about this checklist and what it does?
Yes, so the Prisma checklist is a checklist that keeps you on track throughout the whole process. And as Lars explained, writing a systematic review is quite a process that takes quite a long time. And you need a checklist to keep yourself on track so that in the end you have a fully transparent and replicable process that's reliable and robust so that you yourself can go back in the process and see what you did. And it allows others to check your decisions that you made throughout the process so they trust your final conclusions. So transparency and being clear about your decisions is key. And that helps a lot.
Okay, cool. So we will continue the discussion a bit later. So, Jan, what is the role of the library in systematic reviewing?
Well, the library focuses on the first part of the systematic review, so mostly on the literature searching. We help researchers with workshops and with consultation on how to set up a search strategy, in which databases to search, how to get the results out of those databases, and how to put them into a tool like AS Review or others.
And how can AS Review then actually help those researchers?
Well, first of all, it can save them time mm-hmm. because screening, as Lars already said, is a quite, well, boring but also time-consuming process. So having AS Review can really save them time. But we also see that because it takes a lot of time, that researchers have to make difficult decisions. Can I really search very specifically, or do I cut some corners here? So you can also use AS Review to make your systematic review better, I believe.
What do you mean with better then? Is it then, but maybe also first, how much time? Like an hour or something, or 2 hours, or one and a half years cuts me to like 6 months or something?
Well, it really depends on the size of your systematic review. So when you have to screen thousands and thousands of papers, this will take hundreds of hours. And when with AS Review, you can do this in half the time.
Half the time.
You can save literally days or even weeks
of work. Okay, that's good. And because there's a lot of work pressure in our field. So weeks, we can save weeks with like one tool.
With the larger ones, you can save weeks, yes. There are also smaller.
What's a large? What's large? 10,000 papers?
10,000 of papers, yes.
Okay.
That should be a large one. There's also smaller systematic reviews which have only 1,000, 2,000 papers to screen. So in those reviews, the time saving is less.
Hey, but Felix, coming back to you, because you've introduced this Prisma checklist.
Yes.
And screening abstracts is only one of the steps.
Yes.
Right? So what do you think is the most time-consuming step in the entire process of system? So can you briefly talk us through the steps? So you start with a research question.
Yes.
And you end with a paper.
Yeah. Yeah. And as Jan says, we focus on the search part. So that's where our expertise is.
Yeah.
But you make a lot of decisions throughout the process. And each of those decisions that influences the entire process. And you have to keep track of your decisions and know what was the consequence of maybe setting up your search in a way that you have tens of thousands of papers. Not many people have the time to screen those papers. But if you could use AS Review, you can combine all those papers in the screening process, or if you filter through them more quickly. And so you can make this decision to start looking at 10,000 of papers because it saves a lot of time further down the stream without losing quality. And yeah, it allows you to be fully transparent and work faster, more efficiently, so collect more evidence for your paper.
Yeah, so far we've been talking about saving time, but yeah. There is another aspect of using AI for the process, because you can also have, and Jan introduced me to this topic, but maybe Felix came up with the idea, I can't remember well, but you have the idea of a small search and a wider search. So first of all, why do people have this narrow search?
Well, in a narrow search, or a precise search as we call it, you don't get too much results. So you don't get those 10,000 of papers. And if you're not in a really big research project, if you're only doing a PhD, you don't have a year and a half to do a systematic review, then you are going to make your search more precise. But the more precise your search is, the more papers you might miss in the results. So you would, in a systematic review, actually want to make your search as sensitive as possible, so as wide as possible, so that you don't miss out on any papers.
But it takes you more time then.
It takes you more time, but that is where AsReview comes in. So instead of perhaps saving time, you can put in the same amount of time, but screen more papers and miss out on less research results.
Okay, so now instead of I do 400, can I do like 500,000 papers? Can I do that? Because normally a researcher would never do it, because it's just impossible.
You can do any number of papers. You can do over 100,000 of papers if you need to. It's not always necessary to do that number of papers. Yeah. But you don't have to constrain yourself to a certain number of papers just because this is the number that you can handle in the amount of time that you have. You can make your search bigger and therefore your systematic review better.
Yeah, and Felix, as part of the Prisma checklist, you always have to screen the abstracts with multiple researchers, right? So
yes.
So you have always two or preferably three researchers doing the same search, doing the same screening steps,
yeah,
and then afterwards you compare the.
Yes, so you try to work as transparently as possible. So you need two people so that you're not biased by just one person reviewing everything. And once the reviewing is done, you compare your results. So some will be included by both, and some will be excluded by both. And there's articles left that you are not agreeing upon on the first look. So then you look at those articles that you have a disagreement on, and then you decide whether to include or exclude those.
And Felix, I have a question on that. Well, you have to do a lot of things using that checklist, and the Prisma checklist, and you have a flow chart, and I also do that quite a lot, but it's some steps are just extremely time consuming. Yeah. And I was just wondering, for you, for working from the library, you and Jan, how many people really adhere to this whole process like perfectly? Do they really do all these steps, or is it just more like a Fata Morgana, something which is maybe very nice, but nobody,
yes.
it doesn't really exist in life?
No, the checklist is there, and people know about the checklist. They look up the checklist, they print it out, or they start filling it in. But yeah, at some point their focus drops and they forget about the checklist. And what you then get is a full process that takes a long time. But the steps are no longer transparent. It's no longer replicable. And if they come to us for support, they say, what search did you use? And we have to look back at their process. It's literally a black box, so we can't see where they made mistakes. So a lot of people start using it, but they don't fully complete the whole checklist. And that's a problem. But yeah, as you described in the beginning, it's a lengthy process. Yeah. It takes a lot of time and effort. But if you complete it, you're left with one article that says a lot more than maybe six or seven other articles in one project.
And should they come to you or to Jan earlier on in the process? Because I didn't know, I was looking at Rens also, I didn't really know until I met Rens that there were people in libraries helping researchers. And
yes.
They don't cost us like any money. So would you say, please come to us, come to the library and help me? Because that would be great. And I did send some people already, but is that something we should do?
Yeah, well, doing a systematic review or being a little bit of an information specialist, we think it's a nice skill for all researchers. So we also try to reach out to the educational part of the university and do workshops and try to involve it or incorporate it in the whole curriculum.
And is it also in other, so we are here from Utrecht University, but many people also watching from other types of universities or research centers. Is this normal?
Yes. Well, yeah.
it's not well known, but it's quite normal.
Of course, okay. Utrecht, we are with some expert in this AI screening, but searching and information retrieval is a library thing, and many libraries have this support. But it differs how they offer that and whether it's free or not. But yeah, it's a typical thing that librarians like to do. Well, at least me and Jan, we like to help and assist.
So, and how do you think about using AI in the entire pipeline of systematic reviewing? I mean, AS Review will help you during the screening phase, right? And I guess there are many tools, without going into details of all those tools, but I guess there are many different tools that can help you on the way. Are there more AI tools that can be used somewhere throughout this Prisma checklist, for example, extracting results or maybe even publishing the paper itself?
Yeah, good question.
It's not really our expertise, but you should think, for instance, about data extraction and doing the meta-analysis in a more efficient way. But this is not something the library is really working on, at least not in Utrecht.
No, but your skills are actually shifting from assisting researchers in the search part, and now you become more or less data scientists and AI experts.
Yes, in a systematic review, you could view the literature results and the search and the abstracts and the papers also as a sort of data, and that's also data that is that needs to be processed and that needs to be saved and that needs to be transferred from one to another, and all of this in a very transparent way and reproducible way. So this is a shift in focus for the library.
Yeah,
but it's still it's the literature search that we focus on.
Yeah, and that makes sense because we're less experienced as researchers in that part of the search.
Yeah, I was also wondering, like, what would you want research to do? Like, what are the most important mistakes you as librarians see that researchers conduct? Because I remember some studies that they said if you involve librarians early on in the process, the quality would be much better. But that's all I really remember, to be honest. So do you think, like, okay, researchers should really do this, this, and this to develop better quality?
Well, the search string, so again, the precise or sensitive search is really important. And you do see that researchers miss out on specific keywords, they miss out on specific options in databases. Or
what is an option then? So keyword I get, it's like, okay.
A database, you can search for keywords, so words that are in title or abstract of a paper, but there's also the functionality of the database itself with specific topics that are added to each paper that describe the contents of the paper.
Like the keywords?
Not the keywords, but the subject headings. We name them subject headings,
okay.
Like the MeSH headings in PubMed. And a lot of researchers don't make use of these kind of subject headings, and they really improve your research. But also you have to use a truncation and Boolean operators and put all the brackets at the right place and use the right and or relationships. So sometimes researchers make mistakes in this, and this is something we can help them with.
Okay. And is there like a paper or something you think, okay, this is really how it should be done, like an example paper? Maybe you don't have it, but maybe you say, okay, I was working with this researcher, and maybe we can link it later on or something if you have it. Like, this is really great work.
I don't know any by heart. I don't know if you do, Felix.
Not by heart, but there are some papers that talk you through the process, because it's quite a abstract process, and you lose track of the entire process, and these flowcharts, they help you make it visual, but also just writing it down and explaining it, how the process works of collecting data. So it's data collecting in a database, but people are not familiar with databases, so they lose themselves going into this database. Try to keep the bigger picture in mind. So have the bigger picture in mind and know that your decisions influence later the process.
So okay, so you can go to the Prisma website, which is a website which I do know, but there's no substantive studies, you know. Okay.
Okay, Felix and Jan, many thanks for sharing your ideas and contributing to the project. Let's now have a look at how the software actually looks like, and Sophie van der Brand will give us a live demo. Sophie!
So today I have the honors of presenting our software to you. And let me get started by firing up the software by simply typing command prompt in command prompt ASReview lab, hit enter, and we'll just wait until it gets started. And I'll take this time to talk to you about what I like about ASReview so much. Because if you're using it, then the data that you use stays your own. We don't see it, we don't control it, we don't own it. Everything stays locally stored on your computer. As you can see here, we have landed at our homepage. And you can see the PTSD project I have stored here. And this is actually a really nice demonstration because this is the same project that we talked about earlier today, the PTSD dataset made by Rens. And as you can see here, instead of reading all through all the articles, you would have only needed to screen about 5% to see all the relevant documents already, which is, of course, a lot of time saved. And we want you to do the same, and we want you to have the same opportunity to do so. So how would you use ASReview? Well, in the next part of this demonstration, I'll show you how. So we'll just make a new project together. So let me go back to home and create a new project. We'll have to give it a name. So for today, I'll call it demo, provide it your name. My name is Sophie. And then a short description, demonstration for ASReview TV. There we go. Create. And now we have to set up our project. And first, the first thing we have to do is provide our data. And again, this is locally stored, so we don't see your data at all. And today I have conveniently already created a data set for this, and it's the same data set we've talked about today earlier. It's the PTSD data set. So let me upload this. And as you can see, it has successfully uploaded, meaning that we can quickly and already start with everything else. As Laura also told you, we need to provide some prior information. And since this review was already published, we already know some titles which contain the relevant information. So let me just copy and paste those. And I'll just do two for today, and I'll just do that via the search button. Here you can just type a title or use an author to find those articles that are relevant. And in your own case, you probably know one or two papers that are relevant and which make it really easy to get this through this step. So then we'll just do the second. We'll copy it. And we'll paste it. Or as I like to call it, copy pasta. I did it wrong, but that doesn't matter. I'll just, you know, use one here. I think this one is it. I'll just hit relevant. And for the irrelevant knowledge, we can simply use the random button, because the chances of finding a relevant paper within 6,000 papers is quite slim. So I'll just go with that, and I'll just, you know, read through it real quick and see if it's relevant or not. And it's probably not, so we'll just press irrelevant. And here the same, it's also an irrelevant document. And I'll leave it at that for today, because it would be better to provide some more information, but just for this demonstration, I'll leave it at this. And we can go to the next step, which is also a nice step, selecting an active learning model. And today we'll just go with the defaults because we've done research on them, and we know that these work in all different kinds of situations, and they work easy and fast. So that's what we want today. And we'll just press finish and let ASReview train a model on the background. What's also really nice is that when we're going to start screening, that we stay in control of whether we think or we think that it's relevant or it's not relevant at all. And well, the machine doesn't make your decisions, you do. And I'll show you how we do that. The machine simply gives a suggestion on the papers. This is the suggestion that the machine thinks is the most relevant paper at this point. But we, as researchers, we decide whether that's really the truth. So we have to decide on relevant or irrelevant. So I'll just choose relevant for now, and irrelevant for the next, and irrelevant for the next. And as you can see, this is actually also updated on our statistics bar. So every time you make a decision, this is also updated, which is really nice. Once you're done reviewing, you can actually go back to your project and also download the results. So you can do that here in this section. Like so, and you can just download it as an Excel file, for example. And that's all the basics that you need to know to get started with ASReview yourself. I hope you enjoyed this little demonstration, and I hope you get to enjoy using ASReview soon. Thank you.
Thank you, Sophie. Now that we've discussed the basic idea, we've seen a demonstration of the software, we've discussed how AI fits into the systematic review pipeline, it's now time to actually discover what's going on under the hood. And we have three guests to help us understand the technical process. We have Ayub Bagheri, NLP expert working at the Department of Method and Statistics. We have Jonathan de Bruin, our lead engineer of the software. And we have Daniel Oberski, among many other things, ambassador of the focus area of applied data science all the way from Spain. Hi, Daniel. Are you with us?
Hello, everybody.
Hello. Hi. Okay, cool. So, Jonathan, let's start with you. Can you maybe explain the idea of active learning and why the implementation in ASReview is so special?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. So, in ASReview, we're using active learning, which is a form of machine learning. It's not the most typical form of or most common form of machine learning, but it has a huge potential. And the idea of active learning is that you do have a difference between active learning and passive learning. And passive learning is the traditional way, and active learning is the more advanced way in which you are training a new model. So I'm training a model, and I'm training this model by having some interaction with the model. So you're actually talking with the model. And this is usually not done in the classical way of machine learning. Then you train a model and then okay, I'm done. This is the model, and continue. But with active learning, you have a cycle, and in this cycle, you keep training the model. And I think you can compare this with, for example, if Professor Timmers wants me to learn something completely new, then he can provide me a book, mm-hmm. and then I can learn it myself.
That's what I do. That's what we normally do. We give people, they have to buy them.
Yeah, okay, yeah, they have to buy the book. Of course. Yeah, and that's actually what we call passive learning. So you're sharing your knowledge with me with a book full of examples, mm-hmm. and then I can also apply the way you're thinking to a different data set. But this is not very efficient because actually if Professor Timmers is giving me a short introduction, just 1 minute or so, and then I will ask him a very good question, the question that pops up in my mind at that moment.
You give me feedback or something. Then
I'm asking you, what would I like to know as a model? The professor is the model, the professor and I'm the model, and then you're transferring knowledge by asking intelligence questions, and that's actually what we do.
So then I'm training you, so you are, but via...
But I am asking the questions.
Okay.
So you're providing input, but you're answering my questions, and if we do this in a cycle, then we can train a new model quite fast. And this is especially useful for complicated tasks where labeling is very hard because you need a very good expert.
It's like training on the job versus like reading books.
Exactly, okay. Yeah. And that might be a very, very good thing to improve machine learning. And therefore, we applied this idea to systematic reviewing, because systematic reviewing is always unique. Every systematic review is unique because you are doing research, so you're not going to repeat something you already did. So it's something new, so you don't have anything for reference, there's no book available, so we have to ask smart questions. That's more or less the idea of active learning.
Hey, and Ayub, so you start with a pool of records that are not labeled. So that's a start. You did a search, we discussed that with John and Felix. You have, let's say, 10,000 unlabeled records in the pool. That's how it's called, right? A pool of records. And then?
Yeah, so with the active learning cycle that we have one phase, which is training the model. Mm-hmm. And inside this training model, we can use different models from the traditional machine learning until the neural network models that we can use. And in ASReview, in the back end, we can use models like support vector machines, logistic regression. But these models first need some feature extraction. And for the feature extraction, that comes from the pool that you said. In the pool, we have so many documents, and those are the titles and abstract that Sophie just showed us. So the idea is to first represent these documents to the machine. So for this, we can use some simple ideas like bag of words. And for example, we have TF-IDF, which is term frequency inverse document frequency. And the idea is that just represent the documents numerically for the machine. And this is for the further computation. But we also have much more complicated methods in IceReview. For example, we have the doc2vec, and that's from neural networks, and that's the extension of the word2vec. And the idea is, with this code, that it says that we can learn each word by the company it keeps. And it means that we need to look at the neighborhood of each word to find the meaning. Mm. And that's one issue with the TF-IDF, which is from the back of words. And there, we do not take a look at the order of the words. So we have these pool of data, and we convert that to a matrix, for example, which is a document term matrix. And then we give this to the model, which are the classifiers that we have.
And can I ask you an example, like as an applied researcher? So you have that word2vec or bag of words, but I don't know what to choose. So what do I do? I don't know which one will fit my data set. I just barely know what they mean.
Yeah, so from the research side, it is shown that different models could work differently for different applications. So the idea in IceReview is that to have all the possible methods, so the researcher or the expert could use the best method for its use. But we could also provide the user with the best method with the hyperparameter tuning.
So you could just give me, okay, normally you should choose this, and I just stick with the default, and I just choose it. Is that okay then?
Yeah, so we have a nice set of defaults. So you have to tweak a lot of parameters as a researcher, but we set the defaults. And those defaults are defined on a large collection of data sets which were fully labeled.
Okay.
So we know quite sure that those defaults are performing quite well. But yeah, of course, you can think about, you would like to push the performance to the limits.
Yeah, if people are really, really large, or work together with machine learning specialists or something, they say, okay, this would be work better. But as a normal researcher, I just stick with the default, and then it's okay.
Yes, exactly. And this is also the second part of this project. So we do have our nice user interface for you as a researcher, but we also have a machine learning framework on the other side, where users can or researchers can actually tweak their models, mm-hmm. Such that they can build the best model. And then we look into what model is performing slightly better, because it's like this. We are in the small refinements at the moment. So yeah, that's what we are now pushing to the limit.
So Daniel, can you remember, because it all started with us actually drawing this idea that Jonathan and Ayub were describing, because I was so sick of reviewing more abstracts, and you came back. You walked by my office, and then I asked you, Daniel, can't you come up with something that does this for me? Remember, I think it was 3 years ago,
yeah.
and then you started drawing this on the backside of an exam, I think.
I didn't know it was the backside of an exam. I'm sorry if that led to any trouble.
So
the reason that I was able to do that is basically because we put together a lot of technologies which exist and which are quite mature. So NLP is turned into a mature technology in the past few years. Active learning is also an idea that's already existed for quite a while. And basically we just put the two together. So that's why it was possible to quickly come up with a solution to your problem.
Yeah, and
although we could never
have
guessed it would grow into such a successful project.
Hey, and Daniel, quick is actually the key word, because Sophie just demonstrated the software and you don't see anything about the training of the model. So do you just have to label, I don't know, 100 of papers before a new iteration is trained, or does it happen in a split second? How does that work, and does this differ across models?
How fast the training itself goes, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, that does depend on the model a little bit, but in practice nowadays, computers are more than fast enough to train one with one further data point.
So after each decision, the model is retrained.
Yeah, so I think Jonathan and Ayub already explained quite well. Basically, the way it works is, instead of looking for a big bag of data, turning a big bag of data upside down and then munching that all up, it takes the little bites out of the bag, just those ones it thinks it will need to learn enough to say which paper should be included. So it tries to minimize the amount of training data it actually needs to make a decision.
Yeah, and the performance is actually very well, right? I mean, in the back we see some recall curves. Can you, or any of the others, can you explain what we see in those graphs?
Well, I can explain what we see in those graphs, but I do want to mention one thing, is that what we're seeing here is a kind of pragmatic approach to figuring out if it works. And that's, we collect as much data, as many existing systematic reviews as we can. We see how our system would have performed if it had been used in that situation. And then we, based on that, we make a bunch of different decisions, including, for example, the one that you mentioned before on hyperparameters. Now, of course, all our conclusions then depend on whether the systematic review that the person will do is similar enough to the data sets that we have seen, the systematic reviews that we've evaluated on. The choices we make based on those are good for them as well. And I think that goes for these recall curves, which would show you basically the percentage of true inclusions that the system can detect after a certain number of iterations. They look very well. They look very nice, and they are nice. So, but of course, it's a pragmatic approach. We can never guarantee that this will be. Looks so nice for any possible application. And indeed, sometimes we see in specific applications that the recall curve is less good. And that's very understandable, because it happens also with humans. Yeah, that sometimes it's difficult to find really all the papers that should be included.
Can you maybe explain
those situations the computer has trouble with it also?
Yeah. So are you? Can you maybe explain how then the machinery extracts the information from the abstract? So Daniel just mentioned that some systematic review datasets perform better than others. Is that because the text in the abstract is different?
Yeah. So we have this idea in data science, which is garbage in, garbage out. And it depends on the data that you provide for the system. So as we have seen with the ICE review, we have the titles and abstracts as the input, and we use these to convert them to the input to the machine learning model. And in this input, we have the words from the abstract as the columns. So it is the dictionary that we have, and if we have more data and more labeled data, then we have a better performance. But now with the idea of active learning, which we have the situation which in which we do not have enough labeled data, we can get feedback from the expert and from the user, so we can improve the performance of the modeling. So it depends on how much data you have and how on the quality of the data that you provide to the system.
Yeah. Hey, and Jonathan, in the field of machine learning, new models are being published on a regular basis.
Yeah, I think when we're talking, then a new model is published. Okay. Yeah, so it goes lightning fast. Yeah.
So, how flexible is the software in implementing new models and new feature extraction techniques?
Yeah, so that's actually important. So we are designing our software in such a way that we are more focusing on making a extensible framework and then encourage others and the researchers and our team members to build new models. But I am all the time working on make it as easy as possible to add such a new model to our software. Such that in this way we can work in an open science way and everyone can contribute, and also researchers can more or less compete with each other in finding the best model, because that will actually bring the best model one day. Not that we are doing everything ourselves, so we are asking the audience and everyone who is interested in machine learning try to beat the best model out there, and therefore we are building a flexible framework. So I'm really excited if someone is building a better model than we did, because that's actually what we want.
I think on GitHub we have a page and we can contribute, people can contribute to it, they can just do it
and they can make their own extensions, or they can contribute directly to the project. So that we have a nice protocol on how you should contribute to a project, and that can be for someone who is an expert, but also someone without machine learning knowledge. You can also contribute because we have extensive documentation and all kind of other things you can improve. Anyone can contribute.
Yeah, that's something I also did, for instance, that you had, that was like line breaks, some small things which were very important. If you're, for instance, reviewing not abstracts, but newspaper articles, which I did myself, and then I said that, and now in the end you implemented. I have another question, on maybe for Daniel or for some of you. It's like, it seems, and I've worked together with you, of course, so I know. So it seems all far more efficient, time saving. But the thing, many people ask us, when do I stop? When do I know when enough is enough? When there's no more eligible papers in the very large bag of papers? Because normally we review everything, but How do we do that?
Because that's actually the entire idea of our project, that you should stop early.
Yeah.
Otherwise, there's no performance gain, because then you're still
reading
everything.
Maybe early is too early. Yeah, maybe there are some papers in the end.
Hey, Daniel, I know that you're working on some projects about stopping, but I also know that I learned from you that stopping is an unsolved issue in the field of active learning.
Yes. No, it's much worse than that.
Okay.
Stopping is an unsolvable issue, and that's because the stopping problem, which basically is the following: the system tries to minimize the number of papers it will see in order to make a decision, but at the same time it's always possible that it will miss something, that if it had just one more paper, that it would have done just well enough to increase the performance by some amount.
But can't you simply estimate the number of papers?
On the one hand, it's trying to minimize the number of papers it sees, and on the other hand, it's trying to maximize its performance. And those two things are a trade-off. They trade off against each other. And that is a very well-known problem in this field called the exploration-exploitation trade-off. Mm. So the exploration in this case is seeing a number of papers, and exploitation is including as many relevant papers as possible. And the only things that are possible is to analyze it mathematically, to try to optimize what we can optimize, and then to make a decision. This is what we feel is an acceptable error rate, as an acceptable performance. If you feel that the only acceptable performance is perfect performance, then our system is not for you. but I would give you thing to think about whether there is even such a thing as perfect performance by humans, because I have heard that sometimes humans can also make mistakes.
Okay.
If you don't accept that, then there is no better place to stop than just reviewing everything. And so what we can do is be pragmatic about it. Oh. And that is what we have done. So we have looked again at many real systematic reviews. And we have said, well, what would have happened if we had chosen as a stopping rule, for example, that you stop after you don't see any relevant inclusions for 10 or 20 abstracts? What would have happened if it had been 5? What would have happened if we'd just chosen a different stopping rule? And based on that, we have come to a conclusion of what might be a good stopping rule, what would be the error in different cases.
Hey, Daniel,
but
I talking stress about
that there
stopping
is no
rules.
Such thing as perfect, and that it remains a fundamental trade-off.
Hey, Daniel, talking about stopping rules, it's almost the end of our broadcast. So I think stopping rules is something we should come back to, because as I said, it's unsolved and
unsolvable
even. Oh, okay. Daniel, thank you so much for joining us from all from Spain. Ayub, Jonathan, thank you for joining us. Lars.
Yes.
So, what do you think the impact will be, not specifically about AS Review, but about using AI in the field of systematic reviewing? How disruptive will AI be in your field?
What I hope this talk does, and these views, is that people are going to use it far more, because what I see is there's a lot of really cool science out there. AI research is doing very cool stuff, and I'm very happy to be very close by, learning a little bit about machine learning, and in the end it helps me make substantive decisions. So instead of, okay, we're not reviewing 400 papers, we're starting with 10,000 because we know this is possible. But if you see, I am like what you call in innovation, like I'm an early adopter. I was almost starting. I hope that the large majority, that many people, and even the laggards, that they are also starting to use this. So I think the state of science is already quite far. We published a very cool paper in Nature Machine Intelligence on this. But the next step is people are going to use it. People should start looking at it. It should be very easy to use for scholars. So I hope that. So maybe the science will become better, but the next step is people should use it.
And what's then the future? So what's the next step?
I would say the next step is, so we started with when I started a few years ago with this very large pile of papers. We had those many papers, and I had to review them. I published them, but also PhD students, which I worked together, they did that, and it took a lot of time. And now I have a prop. I have something which I prepared beforehand, and it's called ALOS, and it's what's the, you know, the acronym, why what it stands for?
The Electronic Learning Assistant.
Yeah, so it's like a robot, and I was like, instead of me doing all this work and getting all these papers, I just give him or her, I don't know what it is, but him or her, like 2 or 3 papers, what Sophie taught me. And let's say it's a she. She's going to look at this whole paper and says, okay, maybe this one. So, oh yeah, that's a good one. So she helps me in the end by reviewing a far larger pile. And I know I can use her, but I hope that other scholars are also using her and not just me.
Lars, with that having said, it is now time to end this first episode of AS Review TV. And I would like to thank all of our guests and the entire AS Review team, Utrecht University, and everyone for their contributions. Hope to see you again in our next episode, and that will be about open science. Thank you and goodbye.